Zion Lutheran Church in Chelsea, Michigan. I'm Lay Minister Dale Eckhart, and I'm glad that you've joined us here today. As the summer's winding down, we're beginning to streamline our online service. Many of you are feeling safe enough to come back for in-person worship, so please give us your feedback, either on our Facebook page or in the YouTube comments. All right, let's take a moment and center ourselves to begin worship today. What we're focusing on today in our Bible reading from the Gospel of John is Jesus feeding thousands of people in a miraculous way. Feeding is an act of hospitality, is an act of welcoming. And Jesus welcomes us in, Jesus shows us love, and feeds us too. The second part of our story is a miraculous story with Jesus in a boat, where Jesus finds people where they need him, where he sees their needs, and where he is present when people need him. So let's focus on Jesus this week and begin our worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share this bread with all the world through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from the Old Testament book of 2 Kings, beginning in the 4th chapter. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing food of the first fruits to Elisha, the man of God, 20 loaves of barley and fresh ears of grain in his sack. Elisha said, "Give it to the people and let them eat." But Elisha's servant said, "How can I set this before 100 people?" So Elisha repeated, "Give it to the people and let them eat. For thus says the Lord, they shall eat and have some left." He set it before them, they ate and had some left, according to the word of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our gospel for today is from the Gospel of John, the 6th chapter, beginning right with the first verse. Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up to the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" Jesus said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There's a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, Jesus told the disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." When Jesus realized they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." And then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land towards which they were going. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Welcome, sisters and brothers. Our reading today is a two-parter, as the lectionary often is. We have the story of Jesus feeding 5,000, similar to the stories in the other three Gospels. We have the story of Jesus walking on the water, similar to a story in Matthew and Mark. And Matthew even includes another feeding story where Jesus fed 4,000 people. Now, before you scratch your head, remembering what you heard in Sunday school, I thought there were 5,000. Remember the purpose of the Gospels. These books of the Bible are not a diary of Jesus' day-to-day life. They're not journalists reporting on the history of his ministry. This is not a blog or a podcast or live tweeting what Jesus did every day. The purpose of the Gospels is spiritual, not material, not historical, spiritual. Their purpose is to teach us what Jesus taught them, how God took on flesh and bones and dwelled with us. So, is this one story told different ways or multiple stories? We don't know, truthfully, how many times Jesus fed a crowd using miraculous means. We don't know how many times Jesus walked on water. It could be either of those, but that's not so important. What we do know is that Jesus' life was full of amazing demonstrations of God's love for us. So let's examine the story from John's Gospel. Today, I want to find God's words, God's story in these passages to draw out what John tells us about who Jesus is and who Jesus can be for us. First up, Jesus and his disciples are by the lake. In the previous chapter, Jesus ruffled some feathers by healing on the Sabbath. That was not something good rabbis did. And he followed that up with some bold claims about his relationship with the Father and that he was sent from God. So up on the hills, in the hill country, or maybe it was one really big hill, the words in the Greek aren't very clear, the disciples have gone with Jesus to receive some more teaching, and Jesus sees a big crowd approaching. Now, John's story here connects with other stories in Scripture. He talks about barley loaves, and those are baked goods often used by poorer people, by the common people. Not fancy wheat or rolls, but common barley loaves. And this parallels the Old Testament story I just read about Elisha, where the grain, the first fruits of the harvest, were brought to the man of God, and Elisha used barley to feed the people. Indeed, in the Old Testament story of Ruth, where she comes back from the foreign land of Moab, it's during the barley harvest. So these barley loaves are very much in tune with Jesus' ministry with people. In this story, Jesus blesses the loaves, breaks them, and gives them to the people. Thanks God for the loaves, breaks them, take and eat. What story does that remind you of? It reminds you of the communion liturgy, of what Jesus did on the Passover. Jesus makes connections with the crowd. He's not just speaking at a distance. He distributes the bread. He distributes the fish to them. And in that society, feeding someone, showing hospitality, was an important part of building a relationship. Now, church, I would argue that not only in ancient Judea, but also in Chelsea, Michigan, feeding someone is an important part of building a relationship with them, showing them hospitality. Each month, we share cake to celebrate birthdays and anniversaries. Our vacation Bible school program next week will be providing a meal. We'll be showing hospitality to the kids and the volunteers who are here, building relationships with them. Before the pandemic, we used to offer breakfast between services as a way to build fellowship, and we hope to begin a Saturday morning men's breakfast to again show hospitality, and build relationships with one another. Jesus was demonstrating his love for those people. Now that's a big contrast with the Roman governor or the so-called Jewish king, King Herod, who was ruling over them. They did not go around handing out food to poor people. Jesus was not enriching himself like the nobles did, but Jesus was giving food away. No wonder they called him a prophet. No wonder they wanted to start a revolution and try to make him king. So Jesus left, went back to the hill country or to that one big mountain. They thought they knew what the Messiah should do. They thought they had it all figured out, but Jesus showed them by withdrawing a little that perhaps their idea wasn't entirely correct, that Jesus showed them, that's not who I am. That's not who I will be. That's not the God, the Father who sent me to earth wants me to be. In story number two, we find the disciples getting into a boat. Now, this is similar to some stories in Matthew where people get into boats, and with four fishermen among the disciples, at least four that we know of, they would have had a lot of experience with sailing and boats. Going back across the sea, even at night, wouldn't have been unusual for these men who used boats for a living. Jesus sometimes preached from a boat. But unlike some other stories you may remember, Jesus is not in the boat with them this time. The weather gets rough, there are winds and waves, but notice that the boat isn't sinking. It's just rough weather. And Jesus is not asleep in the back on a pillow, like in that other famous story from Matthew. Storms on the sea or winds and rain is not really unusual in that part of the world. So again, John's gospel links with what Jesus' words say, links with other parts of Scripture. Jesus says to comfort them, "It is I." And later, when Jesus is in the garden and the soldiers come, Jesus asks them, "Who are you looking for?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they say. "I am he," Jesus says. In the Greek, those words are the same. It is I am he. So John is making a clear link between both the time Jesus is present for them on the boat and Jesus is present for them in the garden. Jesus brings them to their destination. We don't see Peter sinking into the water, and we don't hear Jesus saying, "Peace, be still," or giving them a hard time about their lack of faith. In John's telling, Jesus is the focus. Jesus is what we should be looking at. Jesus is present when they need him. And indeed, in the chapter after this story, Jesus meets again with the crowd. They manage to find him in the boat after the boat's journey, and he asks them, "What are you here for?" You almost wonder if Jesus was being sarcastic. "Are you here for more bread? Are you here to see another sign?" But what Jesus tells them in that story is about the bread of life, that he is the bread of life, and not barley loaves that they would eat and be hungry again, but this would fill them. And John links that to a story earlier in the gospel where Jesus is talking to the Samaritan woman by the well. And he talks about giving her not just water, but living water, the water of life, the bread of life, the water of life, the word that became flesh and dwelt among us. The gospel writer is pointing our focus to Jesus and linking Jesus to God's amazing love, the word that became flesh, Emmanuel. John's gospel focuses on Jesus' relationship with individuals. That's a neat thread that runs through many stories in John's gospel. As I mentioned, Jesus talked to that Samaritan woman one-on-one, as an individual, as a person. When Jesus was calling Nathanael under the fig tree, he interacted with him. He had a conversation. "I saw you under the fig tree, and I saw that you wondered, can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Jesus connected with an individual. That John 3:16 story that many of you know. Well, when Jesus says those words, the God so loved the world that he sent his son. When did that happen? That happened at night in the house of Nicodemus, where he's having a conversation one-on-one with Nicodemus. In today's stories, Jesus healing on the Sabbath was one man. He said to him, "Arise, take up your bed and walk." It was not an impersonal healing, it was individual. We hear the names of disciples. Philip is asked a question, and Andrew is the one who answers the question. This is the beauty of Jesus' good news to us, is that God sees us. In baptism, God calls us by name and claims us as his own. Jesus builds a relationship with us. Jesus shows us hospitality. Jesus feeds us with the bread of life and living water. Our salvation does not depend on what we do, but on what Jesus has done for us. The bridges he has built for us, the food he has multiplied for us, the water he has sailed across to get to us. Now, this is good news for people who are in the majority, who are the mainstream, who consider themselves normal people, people in the center. But sisters and brothers, this is especially good news for those who are on the margins, that God sees you and that God loves you. The lepers who were kept out of Jewish society, poor people who had to beg just to survive, women in the Bible who are not even named, just women who are following him. In our present day, we can look at victims of violence or hate, immigrants, foreigners, or homeless, people that we don't even look at as they're standing by the side of the road. In Germany, there are people recovering from a devastating flood, and in California and Oregon, there are devastating fires. I see you, Jesus says. I see all of you. My peace I give to you. My bread I give to you. Now, every day, I sit at my computer and I attend meetings on my screen. Now, I turn my camera on so that other people can see me, but many don't. And if I turned my camera off, do the others still see me? Do they really see me? Do I matter to them? If I turned my camera off and left the room, would anyone really notice? Would anyone really care? Well, Jesus recognizes us. Jesus' camera is always on. Jesus recognizes us by name. Jesus recognizes our joys and our sorrows. Jesus recognizing our hunger and gives us bread. Jesus recognizes our fear and says, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Are you part of a family? Jesus sees you. Are you mourning the loss of a loved one? Jesus sees you. Are you soaking wet, just trying to steer your boat across choppy waves? Jesus sees you. Sisters and brothers, we have been led by the Good Shepherd. We are being fed by the Good Shepherd, who knows us and calls us each by name. I see you. It is I. Do not be afraid. Amen. Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. I will end each petition with, "Hear us, O God." I invite you to respond, "Your mercy is great." We pray for the church. Bless the ministries of our neighboring congregations, lifting up B3 that cares for the environment, Fed Up Ministries at King of Kings, where Pastor Anna feeds both bodies and spirits, and Seriously, which fights addiction and substance abuse in our community. Empower churches throughout the world and encourage missionaries who accompany global neighbors. Kindle in us a spirit of collaboration that all people may know your loving works. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We pray for creation. Send rains to lands experiencing drought and come to the aid of those enduring sweltering heat. Nurture wheat barley, soybean, and corn crops grown for the nourishment of your people, and conserve aquatic habitats and fish populations. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We pray for this assembly. Deepen our resolve to use what we have to serve those in need. When we worry that we do not have enough resources for ministry, assure us of your abundance. Guide our church council and our call committee as they listen to your Spirit's leading. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We pray for those bowed down by heavy burdens, those who are unemployed or underemployed, those unable to find affordable housing, and those without health insurance. Console those who grieve and hear the cries of those who call to you for healing, those on our prayer list, those who are hospitalized in nursing care or in hospice care, those who are on our hearts whom we name aloud or silently. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Remember us in your kingdom, Lord, and teach us to pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. For announcements this week, we have Vacation Bible School that will start up this coming week. We still need volunteers and support to help make this be a wonderful week for the kids. We hope to start our men's breakfast on Saturday, July 31st. Please check the website or the Friday update for details. We have two projects coming up where we will be ministering to other folks, where we will be showing them hospitality, building their relationships. First is Fill the Backpacks, where we collect school supplies, including backpacks, and fill them for kids that are in need. And school supplies are kind of scarce this year, and there are some prices that are going up, so there will definitely be need for kids to have school supplies as they return to school. And another project, which I find really fascinating, the Chip Bag Project. Now, some of you might be wondering, what do we do with chip bags? Well, bags that house potato chips or other chips have a unique plastic and aluminized lining in some cases that can be cleaned and recycled and used in an inventive way to help people. So check for more information on that. Don't bring them in yet, but we will be collecting them to try to help people who are in need. All right, receive this blessing as you go out into your week. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As passionate, devoted followers of Jesus Christ, go out into the world and tell everyone what God has done for you. Have a great week, everyone.
death is defeated.